My local theater recently screened a film called Mr. Blank, Part 4, written by Mr. Outlaw. I was frozen, absolutely, unequivocally frozen. I could only describe the fear that gripped me as visceral. Like I was drowning in a freezing lake of incomprehensible dread, unprepared to face what was ahead of me in the slightest. I looked at Sven, the most capable one of us, but even he looked petrified, his face drained of any color. I looked back at the trees, watching as the pale, gargantuan creature wrapped its disturbing hand entirely around the tree. The high-pitched radio frequency laugh continued around us, seemingly growing louder and louder by the second. And then, out of nowhere, it stopped.
What are you looking at?
A deep, slimy, penetrating voice assaulted my ears. It nearly sounded like it was coming from within my own head. I flinched, taking my eyes off the entity behind the tree for just a moment. It was gone when I looked back up.
Seth?
I heard Rose call out my name. I whipped my head around, nearly passing out in fear upon seeing what was behind me. It was him. Blank face, skeletal torso, giant, bony hands, leering down right at me, only a few inches away. Without even thinking, I began running. I turned back after only a few seconds, watching as the creature's body twisted and contorted, turning into a massive spider-human hybrid with tens of pale, veiny limbs crawling towards me. I nearly threw up right there. Sven drew his pistol and began shooting. Due to how erratically it was moving, he missed every shot except for one. One which drilled straight through the creature's head, causing a wave of thick, black blood to burst from the other side of its temple. It went limp immediately, with its limbs crumpling and falling to the ground. For a moment, I suppose I was relieved. But then I realized what kind of monster we were dealing with. The laughing had come back, louder than ever.
That hurt.
I blinked once and the corpse had disappeared. And then I noticed a hulking shadow looming somewhere next to me. I looked over, watching as the creature, now back in its humanoid skeleton form, wrapped one of its hands around Sven's neck. With the other hand, it grabbed one of his wrist, instantaneously crushing it into a bloody pulp. As Sven grunted in agony, the creature turned to look directly at me. The bottom half of its face began distorting. Soon enough, a human mouth emerged from underneath its skin. If I was close to puking before, I couldn't help myself now. I retched, before looking back up to see it smiling at me. Not only that, the smile was familiar. Soft, pink lips, glowing white teeth that were just slightly crooked at the bottom. It was Lacey's smile.
What are you doing, Seth? Come to find me?
It was her voice, unmistakably identical. I heard myself whimper. I blinked one more time and it disappeared again. Sven dropped to the ground, still grimacing at his gruesome injury. Mike and Rose were in abject shock. I could feel tears begin swelling up in my eyes.
Start running!
Again, the voice came from everywhere and nowhere at once. I began hearing what sounded like heavy, animalistic movements approaching fast. I turned around, seeing something barreling towards us. It looked comparable in appearance to a gorilla with dark fur, but with about three times as many limbs. It was running at us like an oversized centipede. And, of course, it had a familiar blank face at the front. He wasn't even giving me time to grieve. It's safe to say we took the advice and bolted the other way. Every time I looked back to see if it had finally caught up, the creature always looked like it was moving at an unfathomable pace. Yet, it always remained the same distance behind us. After a while of this, it really felt like I was losing my own grip on reality. As we began to reach the edge of the forest, I remember my vision beginning to blur. I passed out, likely due to a combination of exhaustion, fear, and agony upon hearing Lacey's voice and seeing her lips on that monster. I woke up back at Mike's apartment, clothes dirty, cold sweat running down my forehead, and my joints aching. It had become dark outside. I suppose I had been out for a while. Mike and Rose were sitting on the other couch, neither saying a word or even looking up. I can't really blame them, I suppose. Not after an experience like that. "Where's Sven?" I finally asked.
He left. Drove off, said that he had something urgent to do,"
Rose answered. After a few moments,
"He never even went to the hospital before leaving town. I don't think he's coming back."
Well, I guess we weren't going to get any more help from him, I thought to myself. I decided to stay at my parents' place for a bit. They were really happy to see me, but I wasn't really there emotionally. I hated to admit it, but the whole encounter had taken a lot out of me. As much as I still wanted to somehow save Lacey, I couldn't stand the idea of facing that thing again. I needed time to overcome my fears, time to recover before looking for any more answers. But Mr. Blank wouldn't even let me do that. For the first few nights, everything was normal. I used some of my vacation days to get off work, and I spent my time watching TV and playing games, trying to motivate myself to stop being so scared and looking for her again. It wasn't working so well, though. I was still petrified at the very thought of it. But after a few nights, the tapping started. It sounded like a bony finger rapping on my window during the dead of night. I never bothered looking, of course. When I didn't react to that, Mr. Blank began messing with me in more severe ways. I would see a hulking shadow behind my shower curtains just seconds after I'd stepped in. A pair of legs sticking out from underneath my bed as I was getting ready to go to sleep. An unwanted passenger in the back seat of my vehicle at night. Employees following me around the grocery store and staring at me in restaurants. I never could make out any of their facial features. It was all starting to take a heavy toll on my mind. I could feel my sanity slipping away by the hour. I called Mike and Rose. It was the same story. Rose's voice was monotonous, devoid of any kind of emotion. Mike sounded like he was on the verge of tears. But what made everything infinitely worse was the knowledge that at any point, he or it could kill me in a split second. So that begged the question, why didn't it? What was the point of messing with me like this? It all came to a boiling point while I was grabbing my mail. As I was getting ready to reach in, a bloody hand poked out of my mailbox and hauled my envelopes to me.
How generous. It was all starting to become rather bothersome. I freaked out right then and there. I screamed, "What do you want from me?" I grabbed the door to the mailbox and slammed it into the hand until I heard bones begin to break. For the first time in a while, fear wasn't my dominant emotion. It was anger. After enduring the punishment, the hand eventually retreated. I bent down, staring directly into the now empty slot. "Where is Lacey?" I screamed at it. My screams were beginning to attract the attention of my neighbors. Not that I cared. I could hardly keep my frustrations in at that point. I had to let it out. "Why don't you just kill me? I guess I'll find you and kill you first," I screamed at the mailbox. I hardly believed in what I was saying. The words were simply pouring out of my mouth. I slammed the door shut and stormed back into my house. I took some time for self-reflection. The cops had told me to let it go from the start. Heck, even my own parents were telling me that. So, why hadn't I? Why couldn't I just let it go? Maybe it's because I hadn't lost hope. For one reason or another, I still believed that I could get Lacey back. That I could somehow overcome this horrific, seemingly impossible enemy and come out victorious in the end. After all, if Mr. Blank could imitate Lacey's voice, then it meant that she was still alive, right? Perhaps that was a stretch, but I didn't allow myself to believe that. It would be comparable to admitting defeat right then and there. There was also another thing driving me forward. If I didn't face it head on, this thing was never going to leave me alone. I remembered what I'd told myself from the beginning, that I wasn't going to let it end like this. Whenever I'd backed down from a conflict before, my father had always told me to grow a pair of balls and man up. It kind of made me hate him at times, but suddenly, that seemed like rather sound advice. I spent the next few days getting off my ass and preparing to head back into the forest. I was going to keep following the tree carvings, our only real lead, wherever they might lead me. It was pretty obvious that physical attacks weren't bringing this thing down. I mean, I wasn't even trying to kill it. I needed information first. Like, where was it keeping Lacey? However, physical wounds did seem to bother it. In some marginal capacity, at least. While I was brainstorming, I noticed something else as well. Ever since the mailbox incident, the thing had left me alone. My first act of defense against it. There had to be a correlation there. I decided to call Mike and Rose again. They still sounded frightened. Defeated. Mr. Blank was still going after them. What did this mean? I only had my theories, of course. Nevertheless, they were theories worth testing. I began putting together my own mini arsenal. My dad's pistol. One of Mike's shotguns that I had borrowed a few weeks back, a hunting knife, and a baseball bat for good measure. Was I trained in armed or unarmed combat? No. But I still had a puncher's chance, though. I decided to head back into the forest exactly 1 week after I had first gone in. I had made my preparations, of course. I wrote a letter to my parents, in case I didn't come back. I wrote a letter for Mike, one for Rose. I didn't even bother asking them to come. They sounded like they weren't even ready to leave their rooms when I finished talking to them last. I wasn't quite sure what to put in the letters. I just felt obligated to write them.
an explanation, I suppose. Before heading out of my house, I slugged back one swig of whiskey, two cups of coffee, and I tried to calm my nerves. It really didn't work, but it didn't matter. Before I knew it, I was standing back at the edge of the forest alone. I took a stab, a deep breath, another stab. The nerves had come back. One more stab. My legs began shaking. It was as if the fear that I had been suppressing began rushing back to me all at once. I looked up and something caught my eye. A large figure obscured by the woods, creeping along my line of vision. A familiar hand wrapped around one of the trees, dangling a severed hand by one pinky. Sven's hand, most likely. It was taunting me. Every fiber of my being was telling me to turn back and run away. And I nearly did just that. I was petrified, but that didn't mean that I could stop. This thing wasn't going to stop following me at the forest. It knew where I lived, knew how to push my buttons, how to get under my skin. It knew nearly everything about me. I was too deep into this mess already. I only had two choices: face my fears and deal with it myself, or end up like Jay and leave Lacey trapped in whatever hell she was currently in. With that in my mind, I took another deep breath and I began walking right towards it. As I had suspected, it disappeared shortly after, like I had somehow scared it off. Even though that probably wasn't the case, I smiled to myself, reveling at the idea. From there, I began following the carvings, retracing our steps from a week prior. But I was planning on getting further this time. As expected, Mr. Blank didn't leave me alone after I'd entered. In fact, I was pretty much on my toes the entire time. About 5 minutes in, I heard something breathing down the back of my neck. I remembered what had happened to Sven and immediately pivoted sideways. At that point, it was the closest that I'd ever gotten to it. This time, it had taken on a gargoyle-esque form, wings and all. I pulled out my pistol and fired about 4 shots at it. I never had great aim, so only one bullet even grazed it. But I think that my message was sent because it disappeared with a blink immediately after that. It hurled its share of auditory torments at me as well, screaming horrible things at me in a generic demonic voice. The only time that these really affected me was when it was imitating Lacey. It appeared 2 more times before it finally managed to hurt me. However, the attacks were awkward. It obviously could have killed me at any point, yet it seemed bent on trying to only give me non-lethal injuries. Nevertheless, it succeeded. Have you ever seen fan art of the Rake? A classic creepypasta. Well, that's what it turned into, only with no face. It managed to slash my thigh. Not a deep cut, but it still hurt. I responded by breaking my bat over its head. Even though doing so caused it to disappear, it was a move that I regretted instantly. I lost one of my close quarter weapons. I used to play baseball, but I had never used a knife for anything beyond chopping onions. I calmed down, telling myself that at the very least, it wasn't going to kill me. Boy, was I wrong there. After only a minute, it crawled out of the dirt in the form of a familiar machete-wielding zombie, wearing a hockey mask, and it nearly took my head off. I managed to dodge the swing by a hair, and the tree beside me was sliced clean in half. I guess that Mr. Blank was something of a cinephile. I suppose that made sense. That didn't look non-lethal to me, I thought to myself. I scrambled to pull out my shotgun and I blew off the wannabe Jason's head. However, it took both shots to do so, and I wasn't very fast at reloading. Mr. Blank suddenly appeared behind me, now as a hulking, faceless clown, carrying what looked like a lead bowling pin. At that moment, I was defenseless. It swung the pin, breaking the shotgun in half as I attempted to defend myself with it. After that, I started running. What was I thinking? I thought to myself. This monster could basically teleport. It suddenly stepped out from a tree in front of me. This time, it had turned into one of the nurses from Silent Hill, bolting at me with a rusty knife. I shouted. It looked like Mr. Blank wasn't pulling any more punches. It caused me to experience a new kind of fear, not dread or some vague fear of the unknown. No, it was fear of immediate and certain death. But at the same time, I could feel the adrenaline pumping through my veins. I tried convincing myself that I was ready. Knowing that I couldn't run, I pulled out my own knife and I tried bracing myself. This is going to hurt, I thought to myself. As it got within a few feet of me, the crack of a heavy shotgun caused me to flinch. The nurse was subsequently sawed in half at the torso, with stray fragments of buckshot littering the trees beside me. Jesus, I shouted, panting.
Hey boy, best not be taking the Lord's name in vain there, said an unfamiliar voice with a heavy southern twang.
We weren't anywhere near the south. I looked over, seeing two wholly unexpected figures. One was Sven, with heavy bandages wrapped around his wrist. He wasn't the one that had fired the shot, though. Standing next to him was a tall, bulky man with messy blonde hair, wearing what looked like a heavy tactical jacket and camo hunting pants. He was carrying a massive, industrial-looking shotgun. Certainly not anything police-grade. It didn't even look like something the military would use.
Anyways, it's your lucky day, the man said, slinging the weapon over his shoulder.
Sven looked at me and smiled.
I told your friend I was coming back, he said. I don't think she believed me, though.
He looked at his shotgun-wielding friend.
So, what do you think? I told you I had something big.
The man chuckled, watching as the nurse corpse disappeared into thin air, just as every one of Mr. Blank's forms tended to do.
Well, I'll be, he said, smiling to himself. That's a strange one for sure. No matter. I'm itching for a good old-fashioned battle.
What? Was the only thing I could muster out, given how truly bizarre the circumstances had become.
Hush up there,
the man said, aiming his shotgun at something behind me.
Looks like it's itching for the same battle.
I turned around, watching as Michael Myers dropped down from a tree. Only he wasn't carrying a kitchen knife. He had a chainsaw. It looked like Mr. Blank was getting his films mixed up. Asking any more questions seemed like a lost cause. In any case, I needed to focus on the task at hand, staying alive while searching for Lacey. But it looks like I'll have some much-needed help now. I can't complain about that.